I trust that the audio is going to be good on this one, and I want to thank the viewer who pointed out that the audio of my videos was choppy, because I don't have the time to listen to my own videos after I edit them, so I'm unaware that the audio was choppy. So thanks everyone for putting up with that choppy audio, and hopefully we've smoothed it out and just in time, because I'm telling you, the constellation of indications that I got today was quite extraordinary. We are really in the midst of a big push right now. May is the month, and just happens that May 24th, the current president, which is president number 44, will be been in office 4 years, 4 months, and 4 days. On 24 and 2/4, which is 7/4. So numerologists will have a field day with that, won't they? Depending on what you view 44 as. And some view it actually quite negatively, as a matter of fact. It's the day of the fourth dimension. It's the day that the fourth dimension pounces, okay? What I got today was very powerful, strong signs that the fourth dimension is about ready to pounce on this planet and seize control. How this will happen specifically, I don't know. I've had some dreams and I can't quite remember what they are, but something is definitely going to happen coming up. Not a good thing at all. Whichever way it goes, instability is not a good thing. Okay, so let's get that straight. What we want in this country and the world is stability at this time. We don't want instability for any reason. It doesn't matter what side people are on, you know, toppling the other side is not a good scene at all. Not a good scene at all. It'll destabilize things. So what I see coming up, it could be a destabilization. So, just in time, we have the great stabilizer, which is this wonderful spiritual equation, which is, my spirit is not in competition with time. My spirit is not in competition with time. Or, spirit is not in competition with time. Not ever, not now, not in the past, not in the future. There is no competition between spirit and time, although time insists that there is. Time is diluted in this. Completely diluted. It thinks that it's protecting spirit. It makes helping spirit win the competition, as it were. There is no competition between spirit and time. Never has been and never will be. And so this is the great stabilizer. As destabilization comes up, we need the great stabilizer. So this is something that anybody can apply at any time, anywhere. It's simply to say, my spirit is not in competition with time. Not at all. My spirit is not in competition with time, even in the tiniest, slightest bit. Absolutely no competition with time whatsoever. It's impossible. My spirit can be competition with time. So, the fourth dimension, you might say, is the belief that there is this great competition, and that fourth dimension is helping spirit win this competition, as it were. There is no competition. That's how you skip the fourth and go to the fifth. The numbers you want are 5, 5, 5, 7, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5. You want fives. Okay, you don't want fours. You want fives. You get fives by telling yourself, my spirit is not in competition with time. Okay. Fourth dimensional is what I got today is that they're going to make trouble. They are very aggressive, very crafty, and at some point they get the enough push to really make trouble here on this planet. And So when they make their push, are they pushed, as they say in German, the pushed beer hall, pushed. When they make their beer hall pushed, we must employ the great invocation, the great spiritual equation. My spirit is not in competition with time. My spirit has never been in competition with time, and never will be in competition with time. My spirit will never be in competition with time. What does that do? It enables you to shift into the stability of what's called the fifth dimension. Fifth dimensional stability. Where it's seen that everything that time is doing is just a play of insanity. And time is pitting symbols against each other and defining one as representing spirit and one representing time, or the good guys, bad guys kind of thing. And this is all just a complete delusion to try to booster its own supposed strength, because it's defending against total mental chaos. And it doesn't understand. Well, it's not aware, apparently aware, or it has no choice but to do this, because it comes from the idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator. All right. And spirit can choose a different idea and say, no, I don't want to become prime creator. And then none of this defense is necessary. So the fourth dimension is not necessary. For those who see this, they say, there's no reason for any competition. There's no reason for spirit, for mind to try and boost its sense of power by winning some competition. You see, completely unnecessary and absurd. Spirit, truth is not in competition with lies. So, boy, the constellation of incidents that today was a cluster, was so intense, so incredible. I'm shaken up by it. Very bad stuff. And I just trust that I'm not the target of this stuff. And in taking it in as indicating what the whole situation is, you see. The fourth dimensionals, they want this planet. And the third dimensionals don't understand how aggressive the fourth dimensionals can be, and how they feel a sense of entitlement. How can they feel entitlement to something that they didn't have anything to do with, really? But they do. They have this. They're able to psych themselves up into a sense of entitlement, which again is just to play time. It's just the mind, again, playing this idea of limiting loss, of competition, of pretending that somehow something's at stake. How can nothing be something at stake? There's nothing at stake, really. Reality's not at stake. Spirit's not at stake. Truth is not at stake. Life is not at stake. So, what's at stake here? Just this play of loss. Someone gaining and someone else losing. Okay, just this constant play of gradual loss. And then the belief that somehow spirit hangs in the balance depending on who wins and the game, etc. It's all nonsense. My spirit is not in competition with time. Can't, never will be. And truth is not at the mercy of consensus, or time, or even the mind. Truth is not at the mercy of the mind. My insides are humming. I had a very bad dream last night, actually. It showed me what's going on, and I can't quite get into it right at this point, because if I do, I probably would get a bunch of labels thrown at me. Change is constant in the dance of time, and it oftentimes is extremely aggressive and doesn't care what came before, whatever. Time simply moves in and pushes others, bullies and pushes. You know, there's bullying going on, there's pushing out going beyond, there's intimidation, all this stuff. And, of course, it always tries to cast a pretty innocent face to it all. But you can easily see through that if you're not fooled by all the so-called this junk sugarcoating of it all. And there have been examples, where you build up resources, you can be sure that there are those who are plotting to steal those resources. You can be sure of it. And you can tell how superficial it is. It is if you give the appearance of having resources but don't have any, and you're still targeted because all people see is the superficial cover of the book. They don't read the book, you see. They don't read the book. So, coming up in May, let's say May 24th is a pretty good day to look at. Turmoil. And I have a bad feeling about it. So, what to do? What to do? My spirit is not in competition with time. What we need, who knows what we need? We better find it, though, really soon. We better find it soon. Because it is, it's go time. It's going to be go time. And you would think that destabilization would be coming. That's probably what's coming. And the fourth dimensionals, they don't play fair. Okay, let me reiterate this. They don't play fair at all. And we're used to a third dimensional structure here, and we're just pushovers for them. As the slogan for ETs is, they say, Earth girls are easy. You know, one of the tongue-in-cheek sins of the ETs, Earth girls are easy, meaning third-dimensional people are pushovers. Because we're trusting, we're friendly, we're trusting, we're kind, we're gracious, and we, you know, we try to do all that stuff. And so when somebody, fourth-dimensionals, play on our heartstrings like that and talk about all this blah, 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 heart this, heart that, you know. And we're suckers for that. Or praise the beauty of things. Oh, so beautiful, so heart, all this kind of stuff. We're suckers for that. But you don't have to be. You don't have to be. But it's our natural, it's a natural reaction of those who are used to 3D to have that sentimental, romantic feeling of pride in this world. They're dimensional and all this stuff, and that's easily exploited. So, third dimensionals are no match for fourth dimensionals. And even if you're fifth dimensional, you have to pretend to be a third dimensional here, you see. That's my problem. I have to pretend to be a third dimensional, so my reactions are not adamant as they should be publicly. I act like a third dimensional. When in Rome, do as Romans do. Now, I could certainly stand up to the fourth dimensionals, but they would then go screaming and crying and hiding under the skirts of third dimensionals and claim that they're being bullied or being picked on, or they would invoke all these labels. They'd throw all these labels. They're very adept at that, and that's what they've done here. They've termited themselves into the situation here. And then any time they get criticized, they go running for protection. From the third dimensionals, they claim they're being discriminated against in some way. So if you try to speak up as a fifth dimensional and point out what they're doing actually, then they again will claim that, you know, severe discrimination, all these, you know, labels that they throw at you, and the legal system's been changed and tweaked to the point now where they can prosecute you for criticizing them. They don't like to be criticized. Fourth dimensionals don't like to be criticized. They hate it. They really hate it. And I can certainly be critical of them, and rightly so. Just as I'm very critical of time, although I recognize that what time is doing is necessary in relation to the idea of wanting to be prime creator, a spirit wanting to be prime creator. It's necessary to defend against mental chaos. However, that doesn't make the demands of time real. Give time authority over spirit. It does not. And time is insisting that it has authority over spirit, or the question is in hanging in the balance, depending. There's a competition between who has the authority. Is it time or is it spirit? You see, and there is no competition. Zero. It's spirit. The authority rests where God placed it, which is with spirit. And it's not with time, and it's not, mind does not tell spirit what to do, even though it's pretending that that authority now rests with it to do that. It does not. So the first dimensionals are basically time worshippers and mind worshippers. And they try to bully and boss everyone around and claim that they have authority over spirit, or this authority is something that is up for grabs, okay, even though it's not at all. So there's a total divergence, you see, between time worshippers and those who abide in the spirit and spiritual truth, who know that there is no competition between spirit and time. And spirit is the one that chooses ideas. Spirit is at the level of causation. Mind presents the ideas that spirit chooses, but mind is not the level of causation. It's not the level of choosing ideas. So mind is not the authority. It is not. And so we know that. And yet time worshippers are third and fourth dimension. They don't know that. Third dimensionals don't know it, but they're not so sure of themselves in their opposition to truth, whereas fourth dimensionals feel very arrogant and elitist about their capacity to voice this, you know, their skill in perpetrating this falsehood. So they're more difficult to deal with. Not really so difficult if you employ fifth dimensional direct truth to them, but that is something third dimensionals are freaked out about too. They say, whoa, that's too strong, coming on too strong. They say, make it softer, let's be nice. See, third dimensionals love to be very hospitable and nice, right? So they say, come on in, that's no problem. I still do that, you know, which is crazy. Very bad. Getting tripped up like that. Not good at all. But again, what's the remedy is fifth dimension. Fifth dimension is the remedy. The stability of fifth dimension, where we know that spirit is not in competition with time. That's the fifth dimension, okay? So this mantra is a fifth dimensional mantra that I'm giving out here. With the grace of the Holy Spirit somehow helping me to see this and be able to bring it through to this third dimensional level of consciousness. Spirit is not in competition with time. That's a fifth dimensional realization. The fifth dimension that is realized and known. So as you employ this this mantra, this equation, this prayer, this invocation, this clarification, this statement, the spiritual equation, you say, my spirit is not in competition with time. See, in the fifth dimension, we see that. We know it to be true. There's no doubt about it. Whereas here in the third, if we come here in this world, we get all confused about it. And we think, well, maybe it is. Maybe there is some competition. No. So by using this, keep using it, my spirit is not in competition with time. You will lift yourself up into fifth dimensional awareness consciousness. And then from there, your options will be open. Actually, options, potentially relocation options, which is would be a pretty good idea, I would say, the way that things are shaping up here in the future. But first, you have to elevate your consciousness to fifth dimensional, at least get conceptually comfortable with it. So this statement, the spiritual equation, my spirit is not in competition with time. It has never been in competition with time. It never will be in competition with time. It has never been and it never will. My spirit is not in competition with time right now. Never has been and never will be. And continue to make that statement adamantly as you can. And this is like a propulsion system into the fifth dimension. People think, how do you get to the fifth dimension? Where's the rocket? The rocket is the spiritual equation. The spaceship is the spiritual equation. That is the mothership. Okay, that's how you lock into the consciousness of fifth dimension, as it were, is to realize and accept this, is my spirit is not in competition with time. Never has been in competition with time. Never will be in competition with time. See? Only the false self, it seems to be in competition with time. But that's not the true self at all. It's something that time has just imagined, just an image, a symbol. A self-concept is in competition with time. But the self, my spirit, is not in competition with time. So what happens is, it's like you're playing a video game and you're assigned like an avatar and you're playing and you get identified with that avatar and you're trying to get that avatar to win. You don't realize that avatar has absolutely nothing to do with you. After a while, if you fought all these battles and done all this stuff, you get so attached to this avatar and you think it's part of what you are. It is not. The false self is not part of what we are. It's something that time has tricked us into identifying with and believing that it is part of what we are. So we're engaged with it and we want to get it to win the competition. You see, it's taking that time is structuring here. It's not true. It's not part of what we are. Never has been, never will be. And this is when we use the spiritual equation, we begin to realize this. Begin to say, it's okay, I can see this. My spirit is not in competition with time. My spirit is not in competition with time. My true self is not in competition with time. Never has been and never will be. So these are desperate times, actually, right now. Very scary times. I'm nervous, I tell you. When you get warned and warned and warned and warned and warned. And then actually I prayed, what do I do, Holy Spirit? And then I was told, fifth dimension. That's what it was came to. You can do it. They said, you can do it. Fifth dimension, we can do it. We have to do it. We have to do it. And boy, it would sure be nice to get some help. I don't know. I am trying. Let's everybody send some prayers for help. We need the boost to be really effective with our efforts. Really, really effective. There's no joke. There's no joke. What's coming is not a joke. Fourth dimensionals don't fool around. Again, I tell you, they don't like being opposed. They don't like being opposed at all. And I've had some interaction with fourth dimensionals, actually. And of course, they didn't like it. Because I had interacted with them in a fifth dimensional way, and they don't like you standing up to them one bit. It's not like a third dimensional, believe me. It is not the same. It is not the same. Us third dimensionals, if we were left our own devices, we can get along fairly well. Of course, there are problems, of course, but we have ways. Of sitting down, having a powwow, you know, and saying, hey, look, we're going to have some disagreements, okay? And we may not like one another. It's like United States freedom of speech. Look, we're free to disagree. We're free to dislike one another. We're free to have our feelings hurt and hurt others' feelings, et cetera, et cetera. That's okay. We understand that's bound to happen. And we put up with it. And we say it's worth it. Fourth dimensionals can't tolerate that. They cannot tolerate free speech. Fourth dimensionals, they cannot tolerate criticism. They cannot tolerate them being called names or described in ways that they don't agree with. They absolutely cannot tolerate it. And literally, they feel that those who do not do things the way they want are not worthy to live. Okay, that's how severe they are. They're very intense complexes along these lines that we third dimensionals don't have. You know, we grew up people hurling insults at each other and stuff, and that toughens us up, and we just okay, no problem, let's have a beer. You know, we insult each other, some tears, etc. Let's go have a beer or something. And, hey, you know, and, all right. No problem. And we have sort of an underlying respect for one another that, you know, it's there. Fourth dimensionals are not that way. They're not that way. They feel that when they tell you something, they don't want you, they think they know what's right and what's best for you, et cetera, et cetera. So look out, because they've been on the march. The fourth dimensional mindset has been on the march here. And it's ready to stage a coup d'etat, really. It is really ready for that. and don't think they won't do it. And at that point, you know, the party's over. The party's over here, because you will not be able to speak up the way you want to, and bring opposition the way you want to, and all that kind of stuff. No, that stuff will be entirely demonized and criminalized, actually. And just remember something very important. It only takes a majority to push all this through. Okay, we see that the problem that third dimensionals have, and fifth dimensionals working here, is we think, well, there's people that still want freedom. There's people that don't want this. And of course there is, and there's a lot. But the fourth dimensionals could care less about that. We think, oh no, there's so many people who still want, you know, freedom. They don't want to be controlled by the fourth dimensionals. Fourth dimensionals say, so what? All they're after is a majority. They say, hey, we have a majority, we can impose our will upon you, game over. That's all they care about. They don't play fair. They don't say, oh, gee, there's 49% that don't want it. They say, who cares? We have 51% that do. Tough luck for all the 49%ers. You see? That's how they play. That is how they play. And third dimensionals don't play that way. Okay, third dimensionals say, wait a minute, I don't have a mandate here. 49% are opposing. No. Let's have a powwow here, folks. Okay, look, right? Third dimensionals have some native wisdom about how to function in third dimensional. Fourth dimensionals imposing their will here. No way. 49%, you're out of luck. You are out of luck, and you're losers. You're on the losing side of history as far as they're concerned. And they could absolutely care less. All they want is majority. Now ask yourself, is there a majority of people in this planet who have been dumbed down enough to accept the fourth dimensional rule on this planet? And I guarantee you there's a majority of people on this planet that will accept fourth dimensional rule. Okay, especially with a coup d'etat, especially with the destabilization that takes place. You can bet that the majority, even if it's a slim majority, is going to run that direction, because they've been dumbed down so badly. The whole dumbing down process was done in advance, specifically for this time now. And it's there. So again, I say to you, don't be foolish in thinking that somehow, just because there's some opposition to it, that you're in a good position. You're not. You're thinking third dimensionally still. Okay, cannot think that way anymore. You have to be able to see it from a fourth dimensional, get inside their shoes, how they see things. And from the fifth dimension, you can do that. From the fifth dimensional consciousness, you can see the fourth dimensionals and pretty much understand, you know, how they function. And so the opposition is not in a good position. Is not in a good position. Ask the middle class, the bourgeois of this Russia, what kind of position they were in. Once the Red Army defeated the White Army, what happened? All these, you know, the bourgeois, the business owners, the landowners, they were rounded up. They were all rounded up and sent in cattle cars to the gulag in Siberia, in the Road of Bones. And they thought, well, it's not possible. It's not possible. There's so many of us. There's no mandate to do this. Doesn't matter, did it? Didn't matter at that point. Because you had some fourth dimensionals running the scene over there, you see. And they were able to have enough dumb people that was dumbed down enough in the shock of World War II, etc. They were able to do that and get rid of the third dimensional power base in Russia. Okay, became Soviet Union. It didn't matter if you had money, if you're bourgeois, middle class, you know, business class, etc. Goodbye, you're being worked to death in Siberia just like that. Okay, so, hey, they always say it can't happen here. As far as fourth dimensionals, they can care less about history. They could absolutely care less about what we think or what we expect or any of that stuff. They absolutely don't care in the slightest bit. They really don't. You might even say they're cold-blooded as far as that goes. Very reptilian as far as that goes. Very cold-blooded. So you can't expect them to play fair at all. Not in the slightest bit. And yet we do. As third dimensionals, we do expect due process and fairness, etc., etc., etc. Decency, compassion, mercy, and all that stuff, all that stuff. I tested a fourth dimensional once, and I asked them to swear on God's holy name that they would do something, and they did. And then they turned around and did exactly the opposite, and I told them, hey, you just broke your promise to God. And they said, I could care less. I could care less. So what? They don't care at all. So they'll literally claim they're making a promise to God, and they'll and just to trick you, and then they'll break it without the slightest bit of conscience whatsoever. You absolutely cannot trust them. Whereas a third dimensional, an oath, you know, a bond, an oath, a promise is a promise. A promise is a promise. And they have this feeling like, you know what, karma, you don't want to generate bad karma by breaking promises and all that kind of stuff. And so it's a whole different game. When the fourth dimensionals bring an entirely different game into play. Once they're running the show, all bets are off. All bets are off. So, the reason why I make these videos with urgency ahead of time is to try to wake up the third dimensional consciousness of those who are here who have contact with their higher consciousness, so like a fifth dimensional consciousness. And wake you up and say, hey, don't expect business as usual. Don't expect things to go unfold fairly at all. They will not unfold fairly at all here. It will be extremely unfair. And you don't want to be one of those people in the gulag saying, oh, those fourth dimensionals, they were so unfair. And everybody saying, yeah, they're terrible. They're so unfair. Hey, you got to be warned ahead of time. If you want to be fifth dimensional, you should be aware ahead of time. And you know they're going to be unfair. And you know what their game is. And you say, hey, folks, my spirit is not in competition with time. Fifth dimension. Okay? So it's being intelligent. You're called upon to use the intelligence of fifth dimension, not third dimension anymore. Third dimension intelligence isn't enough anymore. It's not enough. So you have to rely upon the fifth dimension. So we call upon the fifth dimension compassion and clarity and truth to assist us immediately right now. And thank you, Holy Spirit, for that, because we actually need to be shown the way, not by fourth dimensional, by fifth dimensional, okay, by true fifth dimensional, true higher consciousness that knows that spirit is not in competition with time, that knows it and embodies it. And we have to do everything we can to look at it in that way and to look at the situation here from a higher perspective. So we see the fourth dimensionals, what are they up to really, and how vulnerable the third dimensionals are at a certain point. At a certain point, they become cattle. They really do. And we shouldn't stand on pride, third-dimensional pride. There's nothing to be proud about getting completely outfoxed and overcome. That's nothing to be proud about. Where our pride should be is our access to the fifth-dimensional consciousness, to truth. Our access to truth based on the great teachings that have been given us, especially, I would say, there are several, but in this particular culture, etc., I point out the teachings of Jesus is actually terrific. True fifth dimensional consciousness teachings, if you understand them, and don't try to translate them into a third dimensional paradigm where they don't fit. It's like trying to fit a round peg into a square hole or something like that. When what happened is the third dimensionals translated them into third dimensional ideology, and it became all distorted and weird. And of course, the fourth dimensionals just, you know, brush it off entirely. They don't have time for that. The silliness for them. But if you see it from the fifth dimensional standpoint, then, oh my gosh, it's tremendous, tremendous teaching. Tremendous teaching. Both the Bible and A Course in Miracles are both tremendous teachings from Jesus. If you read them from the standpoint of fifth dimensional consciousness. Which not everybody does that. There's a lot of people on this planet now, third dimensionals, who have translated into a third dimensional consciousness, and they've got it all, you know, upside down, twisted around, and it's a mess. And they're the ones who think that somehow that they have some kind of power here to defeat the fourth dimensionals from a third dimensional standpoint, you know? It's not true. It's not true because they don't play fair. They could care less about your faith in Jesus. They could absolutely care less. You know, you're supposed to be wise. Jesus says you got to be as innocent as a dove or something like that, but as wise as a something. You have to be very wise. You cannot be naive or stupid about the situation here. Jesus is not calling you to be stupid. It's just the opposite, calling you to be fifth dimensionally wise. To know your spirit is not in competition with time. To see through the folly of time, the deception of time, and to realize that you have an option to exchange it. Okay. So by no means are you supposed to dummy and just react to the fourth dimension, react to what they're doing and say, okay, let's get into fisticuffs about this. Oh no, the fourth dimension, they don't play fair at all. They hit below the belt entirely. And there is no honor there. The third dimensionals used to have a lot of honor, right? And there were rules of engagement and all this stuff, and everybody's supposed to act honorably on the battlefield. And then after the battle is over, okay, that's it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then, there's no honor. In fourth dimensional, there's no honor. The ends justify the means. Total control justifies the means. Again, mind is trying to defend against total mental chaos, and to do so, it tries to institute total control. Okay, that's its goal, to control every facet. Utter control, and of course have this hierarchy of command and control coming down from a central bureaucratic control that, like an octopus that controls everything. That's fourth dimensionals. Those are the fourth dimensionals. They're the ones that are taking over this planet and are going to impose their control over every aspect of this planet. And once they decide that's it, they're going to go for it, then the party's over. Absolutely. That's when the fur starts flying, and that's when you want to be able to have the stability of the fifth dimension working for you, and hopefully sidestep the whole situation, whether it's relocation, ascension, I don't know exactly, but we'll get there. No water anywhere. Uh-oh. There's another thing. There's another reason why instituting control is they're running out of fresh water on this planet. And the trouble is, of course, the melting of the Arctic ice. I used to be very, very up to date on all this stuff. And I've let it lapse to some extent. But I'm very aware of the North Atlantic current and the conveyor belt that takes the... Water that is salty gets colder than water that's not salty. The more salt in the water, the colder it can get. The colder water gets, the more it sinks. So up in the North Pole area, you have all this water that's very cold, and somehow there's a concentration of salt there. I think the colder water gets, the more salt it can handle, or something like that. Anyway, it sinks. There's a huge amount of water sinking in the North Pole. It sinks down and hits the ocean floor, okay. Warmer water rises. It's more buoyant. The water in the Gulf Coast of Mexico, along the coast of South America, etc., it rises. Now, the way things are, the rotation of the Earth, etc., there's a conveyor belt of a current. There's a current of warm water that goes up the coast of North America, North Atlantic, goes up to North Atlantic, goes all the way up to the Greenland, North Pole, all that area up in there, where it gets real cold, takes on a lot of salt, and sinks, and flows back down to the Gulf of Mexico, where it gradually rises, gets warms up through the sun, that area, and then it flows back. It's a continuous flow. Now, when the ice melts up north, what happens, it dilutes the saltiness of the water. Okay, you get all this fresh water going into that area up there. The water is not nearly as salty. Okay, what happens, it doesn't get nearly as cold. What does that mean? It doesn't get nearly as heavy. What does that mean? It doesn't sink. What does that mean? It stalls out the conveyor belt. When that current, North Atlantic current, Gulf of Mexico, North Atlantic Current, when that stalls out, if it would stall out, that is going to be a game changer for the planet Earth, for sure. You talk about climate change, you talk about trouble, that's it. Could completely change the climate of Europe and North America and just the whole globe, throw everything out of whack. So you have this massive melting of the global caps. So fourth dimensionals, they do, they're very scientific, they understand all the problems with the globe. There's a lot of problems now. And they see themselves, the white knights, as the saviors. How do they save everything? By putting, clamping down this extreme control on the planet, trying to stop the global warming, trying to stop, you know, all this stuff from happening. Okay. Of course, they don't say that they're the ones who seeded all this technology in the first place that has brought about all this global warming. So they kind of made the problem that they're now here to rescue us from. See, very clever. And then they come in and we say, oh, please help us. Yeah, we'll give you all power and control. They gain complete power control over the planet. And it's now a 4D planet, the planet. So very clever on their part. Which is why I always said we should have stopped progress at the steam age. Okay? Should have stopped it. And the rest of the stuff was fourth dimensional stuff being seeded here that brought us to where we're now, the high tech age. And now we're all screaming, oh my God, look, the planet's dying, look at all the problems we got, and North Atlantic Current might stall out, which it very well might, and all these magnetic frequency, the Earth is changing, all this stuff, everything's messed up, and now we're praying, oh, please, please help up, and here come the fourth dimensionals and say, don't worry, we're here to save you. Yeah, very, very tricky on that part, absolutely. And so, of course, the majority of the people on the planet say, hey, how could you possibly oppose this? What do you want, the planet to die? You want us all to die? That's what they're going to say. And so you feel so guilty if you're opposed to this. Like, you're crazy, you're guilty. But actually, third dimensionals could solve the problems themselves if the fourth dimensionals weren't constantly interfering and pitting, divide and conquer, polarize and conquer, polarize, polarize. Everyone's so polarized. As a matter of fact, we could have gotten together and figured it out a long time ago. But they don't want it figured out, you see. They don't want it figured out until it gets a crisis, and then they ride in on their white horses, you know, and their shiny armor to fix say, hey, we're here to fix all the problems. Don't worry, we have the technology to do it, they say, all right? Yeah, they have the technology to do that and a whole lot of other stuff. We have the technology to control you also. So fifth dimensional is the ticket. You want to get to 5555555555 fifth dimension. You want to get there. So we need the affirmations that get us there. The affirmation of truth that my spirit is not in competition with time. Not in the slightest bit. My spirit is not in the slightest bit in competition with time. Never has been and never will be. And that's a fact. My spirit is not in competition with time. So, we need somebody, you know, we do need somebody that is adamant about this, off the charts adamancy is what I'd say. I'm doing my best, but time is thin at this point, so we'll pray for that. Let's pray for that. You know, it doesn't have to be a guru situation. It doesn't have to be anything at all. It's just somebody, someone who has the true, conveys the true adamancy of this and the truth of it. And it clicks, it gets through to us. We say, yeah, that is true. We stand on that. That is what we need. That can galvanize, not galvanize us on a third dimensional level to oppose fourth dimensions. No, galvanize us to a fifth dimensional awareness and consciousness and acceptance that our spirits are not in competition with time. Never have been, never will be. And we accept this. We decide, hey, you know what? I accept this. I do accept this. That is true, and I accept it. It is true, and I accept it. So I must say, my spirit is not in competition with time. This is true, and I accept it right now. My spirit is not in competition with time, never has been and never will be, and this is true, and I accept this right now. I accept it right now. Okay, this is what we need. because the times for games are long over right now. We have to get to that fifth dimensional awareness. Have to do it real fast. Don't wait for your tomatoes to grow in order to do that, all right? Don't wait for your garden to grow. Forget it. Forget it. Forget it. We have 14 days until May 24th right now. There's another four. There's 1-4, then there's 2-4s there. And then there's a 44, 4 years, 4 months, 4 days, okay? And that's all about the fourth dimension, isn't it? That is the fourth dimensional's day, 7-4s. Don't think that they don't know it. Don't think that they won't utilize it in some way. Don't think that they're not getting ready for us, because they are. They really are. And they're getting very bold. They're getting very bold and very aggressive. And of course, they're playing through, they're hiding under the skirts of third-dimensional patsies, of course. Of course, they always do that until they seize control. But they're hiding under the skirts of third-dimensional patsies. So these third-dimensionals that are just these mouthpieces, you know, for the fourth-dimensional viewpoint. And just because they're third-dimensionals doesn't mean it's third-dimensional viewpoint. It's not. They've just been corrupted. So, of course, they will say, everything's fine. Or we think, this is only coming from third dimensionals. We can handle that. Not true. Not true. They're just mouthpieces for what's behind it. What's behind it all. And there's a lot of mouthpieces, a lot of tin horns that are pretending. We think, there's only third dimensional person saying this. We can talk. We'll be able to work this out. Not true. They're fronting for the fourth dimension here. And you cannot work things out with the fourth dimension. You cannot work it out with them. You absolutely cannot. Because they say, hey, we have our marching orders. And you got a problem, you take it upstairs. But we're not listening to anything you have to say. And there's no dialogue. Forget it. There's no reasoning. We says, we're under mind control, basically. You have a problem, take it up with the... with the mind. Well, fifth dimensionally, we already know the answer. We choose a new idea, exchange hypothetical scenarios, experience bliss, perfect God's perfect non-judgment upon all time, upon all hypothetical scenarios, upon all what-if scenarios, upon all dreaming. No judgment whatsoever. Knowing it's nothing. It's absolutely nothing. And knowing, it's like God looking at time, saying that time's in competition with the reality. Do you think God pays any attention to that? Not in the slightest bit. God knows there's nothing in competition with God, nothing in competition with reality, prime creator. No, there's no competition there at all. So what is there to judge? Is God some kind of judge judging the competition, deciding, you know, how's the competition going? Is God paying attention, you know, watching this competition in the boxing match, and who's landing the blows, and, you know, cheering on this one and that one? No way, no way. God is not paying any attention at all to this bogus competition of time. No, he says, there's nothing there. Nothing there whatsoever. Forget it. No judgment. No judgment. So we need fifth dimensional consciousness here. I'll keep trying. I've been saying this for years. I started in 1997 saying we had to have some help here. We had to get somebody who was super adamant. But you know what? We need somebody that's alive right now. That's how I feel. That is how I feel. That's more potent. You know, using someone from the past, it doesn't seem to have the potency. It just doesn't. But I can't find anybody really that's willing to stand up like this. Who's not so completely nonchalant about it. You know, it's not a nonchalant situation, really, from a practical standpoint. I mean, theoretically, you could say it is, but actually, God doesn't pay any attention at all, so it's not even nonchalant. Whereas bliss could be said to be nonchalant, if you want to say it that way. But from a pragmatic standpoint, it is, time is, God has no mercy. So you had better accept that your spirit is not in competition with time. You'd better get there. So that's not a nonchalant thing. So you need some adamacy there. I feel that way. I could stand corrected at some point. Absolutely, I'm always capable of being a standing corrected on any given issue whatsoever. That's not a problem. But I would say we could use some adamacy right now, and I'm still determined to get it. I hope I do get it. I hope I can share it with the world. I have just a feeble kind of adamancy here. It's kind of feeble. It's not full on. It's not. There's still too much fear about the turmoil to come and repercussions, etc., etc. So I guess don't misinterpret someone who has no fear whatsoever. True, with being nonchalant. No, it's simply that they are completely stable, and they don't have the slightest trouble in being that way. But they do realize. Well, here's an example that Richard Lenoy, who took some pictures of Anandamayi, he wrote a book, a very nice book. Richard Lenoy, and he taped a video with someone, and he explained a story that he put in the book about someone who was about ready to leave the ashram where Sri Anandamayi Ma was, and he was ready to take a train. Okay, and just before he was leaving, she called him and says, "Come here," or he's just saying goodbye or something, and she was wrapping her hair around her finger. Something like that, and twisting the hair around her finger very, very precisely. And she was very serious, and she told him, she says, "Don't take that train. The train that you're going to take, don't take it. Take another." Okay. And he said, "Well, I've got plans. I'm meeting some people at the station, and I'm meeting them, and everything's already planned. I mean, I got to take the train." And she says, "Now, don't take the train." And he said, "Well, thank you, and I'll think about it." And then she stopped him before he left, very serious, super serious and adamant, and says, "He says I never say or do anything without a purpose." Okay, dead serious, scared the heck out of him. Now I don't know if he took the train or not, but what I'm telling you is that. She's saying, "Hey, this is serious business. I'm telling you something very serious and important. I want you to listen to it." Okay, there's nothing nonchalant about that. She said, "Never does anything without a purpose here to help us." So, we could use something very adamant right now. We could use something very adamant. We're not used to it. We're kind of used to, maybe I'll take it under consideration, But we're not used to saying, "Whoa, yeah, that's really serious here. I better." Do what's said, because obviously they are aware of something I'm not aware of. So we could use that. Might shake us up a little bit. That is for sure. I got shaken up today by a fourth dimension. I'll tell you that. And not good at all. Not good at all. There could be trouble coming up in the world. Big trouble. Yeah, sometimes, I know beneath the surface we're aware of what's going on, but trying to bring that to the surface is very difficult, especially if it has to do with sensitive stuff that you really try to make it public and you might get in trouble or something, because people say, "How in the world do you know something like that?" I mean, psychics are always warning people about stuff, and people say, "How do you know about that?" As if somehow you're implicated by knowing something about it. But actually, the fact is that minds are one, mind is one, and everything is known to everybody, what's going on. Everything is known to everybody. We're just pretending it's otherwise. But the pretense is pretty strong. And so we all know what's going to happen in this world. But we don't want to let it bubble up to the surface so it comes out of our mouths. We really don't want to say anything about it. So I've seen some stuff that's going to happen, but I'm kind of holding it, tamping it down, as it were. I don't particularly want to talk about it because I think it would, it might get me in some trouble or something. How do you know about that kind of stuff? That kind of, nobody needs that. We're in such a terrible age right now, you know, where innocent people are bullied to such an extent that they can't take it. False accusations, you know, social media is like a pack of dogs, really. It's like a pack of dogs. And I can handle it in a fifth dimensional way, but not in a third dimensional way. So that's a problem. If you can't satisfy both the third and the fifth right now, you cannot. It's too difficult. You become vulnerable to the fourth dimension. When you try to function in both ways, you become vulnerable to the fourth dimension. So fifth dimension, I can handle all this world and what people, and just like that, if I wanted to, as far as just putting them down, putting them in their place. But from a third dimensional standpoint, that would not seem to be too kosher to do that, you see. And not at all. And people would say, oh my gosh, you're upsetting the fourth dimensionals. They're here to help us. They're here to save our planet. How dare you upset them? You know, that kind of thing. So you got too many of these shaking gelatin third dimensionals here that are all timid, frightened. Don't upset the fourth dimensionals. You know, they're here to help us. And so if you just light into them and just put them in their place, the fourth dimensional will start crying and say, did you hear what they said about me? We're going to go home. We're not going to help you guys. You're so disrespectful to us. You know, you're so disrespectful. I can't believe how disrespectful you are. You know, xenophobic, you know, crazy third dimensionals don't respect us. And then the third dimensional. They'll say, no, please don't go, please don't go, kowtow, you know, and say, we'll deal with that bad one who's disrespectful of you, we'll deal with them, you know, with the pitchforks and the Iron Maiden, put them on the rack, and so it's like that. So, you know, there's a lot of third dimensionals on this planet who are terrified of what's going on, and they feed the fourth dimension, they think that's their only hope, so they're terrified of insulting them. They're afraid they might be insulted and they might pack up their bags and leave. Fat chance of that happening. There's no chance. It's just a bluff. They're not going anywhere. You should heat things up for them. But so it's very difficult to function fifth dimensionally here right now. Extraordinarily difficult. And so I feel in a very vulnerable position. I can't really put the fourth dimensionals in their place the way that they should be. And get me in the third dimensionals would you know, scapegoat me, say, oh, he's causing the fourth dimensionals to get all upset. Can't have that. They might leave. So you see the dilemma we're in? It really is a dilemma. So you can't expect somebody here to just put the fourth dimensionals in their place. They'll get run out of town. They'll be tarred and feathered. I mean, there are some that obliquely kind of try, kind of joust with them, etc., and they're hated. They're absolutely hated, you know. God, the people just loathe them. They're so upset with them. But that's baby stuff. That's baby stuff, really. You get guys like Rush Limbaugh, for instance, who likes pulling people's chains. You know, he likes he's good at it, and he likes pulling people's chains. He'll pull all sorts of chains. And he's yanking on these chains, and that upsets the fourth dimensionals and their proxies and their front people. And they are just absolutely rabid, foaming at the mouth, angry at him. But that's just baby stuff, you know, that he does. That's third dimensional yanking at chains. He just, you know, that's just tweaking from a third dimensional standpoint. But that's not fifth dimensional at all. That's not putting them in their place at all. I put them in their place, it's a whole different thing. You start talking about truth and Jesus and the Holy Spirit in the right way, and that, my, you know, you have no say, time has no say over my spirit whatsoever, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, and you really radiate that. You know, the fourth dimensional will freak out over that. And then they'll go crying to the third dimensional, their third dimensional brown shirts, and say, hey, you know, we can't have that here. So you see, we're in a pickle. We're in a pickle. We're in a pickle. The idea that these you know, right-wing talk show hosts are somehow going to save the world is nonsense. Absolute nonsense. You name it. They're lightweights. They're cream puffs. Okay, you name them. You know, the whole there's a lot of them. The whole package, you know, the Hannitys and the Levins and the Savages and the Limbaughs and all these right-wing talk show hosts, etc. They think, hey, we're standing up to them, you know. No, that is just lightweight stuff entirely. That is just jabbing, you know, at the monster, you know, while they can. you know, say, hey, a little stick and poke him with this little stick or something like that. Let's irritate him if we can. It's sport, you know, they enjoy doing that. But that's nonsense. That's not fifth dimensional stuff at all. It's utterly lightweight. The fourth dimensional is just, you know, we're going to crush you, absolutely crush you. You know, you don't cause us any real problem, just an irritation, just getting us madder. So it is ridiculous to think that they can somehow prevail here. Absolutely not. They absolutely don't understand that they're in over their heads. What they're doing is they see a foot in it. They're stepping. They're poking at the foot or stepping on a foot. They see a foot, but they don't realize what that foot is attached to. Okay, they don't really realize that foot is attached to this gigantic monster. You know, and when that foot decides to pull the curtain, the monster pulls the curtain aside. Then they realize what kind of whose foot they're stepping on, okay? And from a third dimensional standpoint, you cannot deal with that. You cannot deal with it. You're going to crumble. You're going to be broken. I'm telling you this, the right is going to be broken soon. Broken. Very soon. Because they don't know who they're messing with. They really don't. They don't understand it. They don't understand fourth dimensionals. They don't understand extraterrestrials. They don't understand different dimensions. They don't understand time. They don't understand the delusion of time defending against mental chaos, of spirit choosing the idea of being prime creator, of the necessity of repentance. And they don't really understand that. They only understand it at a third dimensional level at best. And that's not good enough at all. It's not good enough at all. You cannot deal with a situation from a third dimensional standpoint. You simply cannot. That's what Jesus told us. You cannot deal with it. It's not business as usual. He said, I come to bring a new testament. Not the same old mosaic third dimensional situation, which is insufficient to deal with the situation. Very much insufficient. So, the New Testament is a fifth dimensional testament. It is a testament that spirit is not in competition with time. Absolutely not. Never will be. Never will be. However, time wants to say, whether that means spirit's lowly or scared or inferior, whatever. Say whatever it wants to say. The fact is, spirit is not in competition with time and never will be. So time doesn't touch it. So who cares what time says? Time doesn't have the last word with spirit. Time does not have the last word with spirit at all. Spirit has the first and the last word, and everything in between, you see. So, if you try to deal with this situation in the fifth dimensional way, people will say you're crazy. And if you try to deal with it in a third dimensional way, they'll start foaming at the mouth and calling you all sorts of names. Terrible names, you know. It's unbelievable. I've been monitoring the whole thing and seeing how it's developing. And the rabidness now, you know, a rabid dog is a whole different story, isn't it? You see, like, an angry dog's like a third dimensional, okay? You can deal with an angry dog. You can. I've dealt with them before. You can deal with an angry dog. You cannot deal with a rabid dog, and a rabid dog's like a fourth dimensional. You try to deal with a rabid dog the way you deal with an angry dog, and you're going to get bit, and you're in big trouble. You know, normal dog is angry, you know. You can stand your ground, get a stick, you know, something, and say, hey, you know, I'm not afraid of you. You want some of me? Come on. And the dog will, like, say, whoa, you know, what do I got here? And it gradually, it'll settle down and, you know, back away, and it's all cool, all right? A rabid dog is a different story. You say, hey, hey, and the rabid dog just goes for you. Forget it. You got to say, I got a stick. Doesn't care. It's rabid. It's mad. It's crazy. So we're dealing with a rabid dog right now in this world. And all this stuff, you know, of this third dimensional bravado, which the right wing is employing, is bravado. Is bravado. It's not well informed of the severity of the situation. It senses it, it feels it, it knows there's something really bad going on, but it doesn't understand the big picture well enough to inform people properly. They should be saying, hey, you need fifth dimension. You need to say, my spirit is not in competition with time. My spirit, and no matter what time wants to say about my spirit, it's still never in competition with time. I don't care if spirit wants to say that I don't care if time wants to say that spirit is nothing, or that spirit is stupid, or spirit's incompetent, or spirit's lowly. Doesn't matter. I'm not in competition with what time says. I am not in competition with time. Period. Okay. Now that's what should be on these radio shows. Okay. That's what should be on Limbaugh's show and all, whatever. All shows. Public radio, whatever. It should be on all shows. That's what we should. That is what the third dimensional should be saying right now. Is my spirit is not in competition with time. All right. That is what the guru should be saying. That is what people should be saying. This should be echoing around the globe right now. And I wish there was some way to push it out there. Right now I have 246 subscribers, which is great. I look at some other channels. There's like one channel I know. It's just fluffy stuff. And they got like, 8,000, 10,000 subscribers. Other stuff like the guys who eat a lot of food have like, 500,000 subscribers. Something like that. And then the sleazy pop stars, they have like millions and millions of subscribers like that. So, oh my gosh. It's amazing. But this spiritual affirmation really would be a game changer. It's a game changer. But how many are willing to have the game changed? But hopefully I can, get more subscribers and somehow I can push this out in some way. Maybe it'll happen. I don't know. It's possible. It is possible. Believe me. So sometimes you can hit a grand slam. I'm not dismissing it. I'm not saying it's impossible. No, it's not. Sometimes stuff can go viral. It is possible that something go viral, and maybe it will. But again, I'm someone who's been in the third dimension here, and I have the mannerisms of third dimensional, and so I'm caught in the middle, which is not good. We need an all outer. We need 100% fifth dimensional here. We really do. We really do. And I don't mean just a lunatic. You see, we're not talking about that. No way. No, fifth dimensioner is absolutely clear as a bell. Absolutely clear as a bell. And they're never not as clear as a bell. All right. They're not just in some trance. They're not in some trance drooling. Okay. They're not just in some altered state. It's not that at all. They absolutely know what's going on. Clear as a bell. And they're not tripped up by third dimensional mannerisms. You see, they're not tripped up by it. They're not intimidated. They just excuse themselves and say, "I'm sorry, I'm not able to, function in that way." And you might think I'm, might think ill me or crazy. I'm quite sorry about that. it doesn't faze them in the slightest bit. That doesn't faze them. So I'm telling God we could certainly use that right now. Praying for it. We'll see what happens. In the meantime, tell yourself, my spirit is not in competition with time. This is the simple one, okay? If you want a simple one, if you want the most powerful, simple statement, affirmation, say, my spirit is not in competition with time. And just try it. As you're doing today, just suddenly kind of say, hey, let me say that. Let me say it right in this situation. See what happens. Because actually, it tunes you into the fifth dimension. It tunes you into it. It tunes you into something. You say, oh my gosh, I can get free of all this stuff. This stuff can't, I can actually choose to have it not touch me at all. I can be untouched by all this time, all this destruction and time, that the assembly line of sacrifice that is time. I can literally stand untouched by it. Right now, as a matter of fact. And you start tuning into this, you see, and this starts building something, is coming into alignment, as it were. I know some talk about the Merkaba or something, the flower of life, something like that. And they go about it by trying to structure something. But I tell you, I would suggest the better way to go about it is to say adamantly, my spirit is not in competition with time. And then whatever comes about from that, that's fine. But don't put the cart before the horse. Put your statement of truth first, and then let the alignment then come about from that. Just stay centered on this statement. My spirit is not in competition with time. Period. I don't care what time says. I don't care what time says at all. My spirit is never in competition with time. My spirit is never in competition with time. It is not in competition with time. It is never in competition with time. So you can say never to me. My spirit is never in competition with time. It makes no difference what time does or says. My spirit is not in competition with time. My spirit is never in competition with time. Period. Forget about all the rest of the stuff. Don't worry about it, because this is the RX, the prescription for freeing you from this madness of time, going to the fifth dimensional awareness of consciousness, where you realize that you're not in competition with time. Absolutely not. Imagine the relief that is. There's this crazy race, crazy contest going on, and you say, that's got nothing to do with me whatsoever, never will have anything to do with me whatsoever. Imagine the relief that brings. It's like the dreamer. Is the dreamer in competition with the dream? Is the dreamer in competition with the dream? The fact is, no. I am not in competition with the dream. I am not in competition with time. I'm never in competition with time. The dreamer is never in competition with the dream. Period. How are we doing here? Pretty good. And we better come out full bore, because the fourth dimensionals are pulling aside the curtain right now. And it's a scary thing. It is a scary thing. I'm just getting my bell rung right now, saying, whoa, you know, better get on this. Full on. And for me, it's a super tough thing, because I'm totally enmeshed in third dimensional functioning. You know, very much relied upon to carry out all sorts of roles. Work all day, shop for everything that's needed, do all the cooking, you know, take care of people in many different ways, and then do the taping here, and take care of all the yard, and just, you know, on and on and on and on, all this third dimensional stuff, trying to be Superman, doing all that. At the same time, trying to get this out, I'm struggling, just trying, you know, to be pure fifth dimensional. It's very, very difficult with me. People would think it would be like some shock to them if I just went into full fifth dimensional mode. They think I've gone crazy, because you see, you can't do that. You got to keep functioning as third dimensional. So it's really difficult for all of us. I'm sure we're all in the same boat that way. You know, I'm sure a lot of us feel like, hey, I could do fifth dimensional, but, you know, I'm not really sure what everybody would say about that. And I'm kind of like, you know, I don't want to let people down and all this kind of thing. I've got so many responsibilities. My gosh. So, we'll see what tomorrow brings on this. But we are setting ourselves up very, very nicely, just in the nick of time. And we really need some adamant treatment here. And I do have an idea. I do have an idea. I can see what's possible. So hopefully the audio has been good on this. Again, and I will... okay, right there. Okay, so this is it. I'm going to call it a day on this. I got to go. All right. Very great.